So let's kick off with Thomas Lund from TC Electronic. He'll talk about loudness in music, iPods and mobile devices, mobile TV, and we'll elaborate in detail on a couple of the points I have addressed also before the lunch break. Thomas, please.
Thank you, Florian. Okay, so from where Florian left before, with the example of, for instance, the cinema and places where we have wide dynamic range or wide loudness range becoming available, and it's being sort of abused. Maybe the first place where this happened systematically was in the music industry. So that has that was, you could call it, set free in maybe 1982 or 1980 or something like around there with the digital recordings, digital multitracks and CD players. But it's come to the way we're using the CD medium, and we are using also in iTunes, is actually a problem nowadays because we generate more and more distortion. So just very briefly, because some of you may have heard this before, let's listen just briefly to a little bit of an Anastasia recording, and then afterwards we'll listen to how much distortion is actually added to this recording when you play it back on your CD player. So try to remember the level now, because the distortion you'll hear in a moment is directly proportional to that when you're using this type of CD player. Maybe you can work your way through the diagram. I'm not going to explain it here, but it's just a way of playing back the distortion that will get added when using a particular CD player. So first here, the original here.
Yeah. Y'all ready to do this one? Alright then. Let's go.
Okay, so here comes the distortion components. Wonderful, isn't it? So that's actually what gets added in your, in this case, NAD CD player, and that's not an atypical one, I would say. So we have several critical areas where this type of distortion can happen, so we need some peak level headroom. In D2A converters, in filters, in sample rate converters, and in data reduction systems. So this type of level is actually created more and more frequently on recent pop releases. So let's just have a brief look at data reduction systems. This is how much headroom is needed with these different codecs. So you can see, for instance, what we call MP3 at 128 kilobits per second for stereo would need between 3 and 5 dB of headroom to be distributed undistorted. But there's also another problem with data reduction, of course, that it adds a lot of artifacts to the sound, and at 128 kilobits per second, even with our best codec, the AAC codec, this is actually quite noticeable. So some of you may be using these procedures already. I know it's an old habit in England, which is a very good habit, to do your MS checks on the delivered sound. But if you listen to the S component after the codec, have a listen first to just a classical duo here. Non-data reduced, and we'll just listen to the S component of that. And then let's hear it afterwards, data reduced. And here comes the data reduced version. Maybe a little bit difficult to hear in a hall like this, but I hope you could hear the artifacts. And it can get worse than this, actually. Right now, let's just hear a pop track, which is at very high level, so I've reduced it by 6 dB before doing the encoding. Now listen to the S component and the artifacts. This generates, this is downloaded not from the music store because this is pre-attenuated, but afterwards I'll play you the version downloaded from music store. So if any of you recognize the guy in that picture, it was Bob Katz. We were together last week or 2 weeks ago, and he sent a photo from Bali afterwards, where he said that was the space monkeys. So, so anyway, this is a bad day downloaded from Music Store, where you may or may not be able to hear the extra distortion that gets added every time the codec breaks down. I don't know if you could hear the additional clicks every time the level was too high. You can in a good studio production environment. So anyway, lossy data reduction is really not something to strive for because bandwidth goes up. We have more than 1,500 times the bandwidth we had in the middle of the 90s when these codecs were developed. So we are not using it in cinema anymore, and you can do lossless in iTunes also. So certainly, please don't use data reduction in any production. You might need it in distribution, but that's not the same. So the problem is that we have a lot of advanced technology nowadays, but we're actually delivering junk to the audience. We are hypercompressing, and we're using lossy data reduction. So not good. One thing, of course, in the right direction is the initiative by EBU and by ATSC and by the ITU to get rid of peak level normalization, because that's actually at the root at least of one of our problems, the hyper level thing. Because the problem here is that we have pop music and commercial systematically louder than everything else when we're just using peak level as our measurement or as our guidance. So a brief example of peak level normalization here in broadcast to your left.
Pleading guilty? What kind of a strategy is that?
He'd only be pleading to manslaughter.
It's still 10 years in prison.
Well, which is better than life. And that's what Mike's risking if he goes to trial. With good behavior, he could be out in 5.
With a better lawyer, he'd be out in 0. We need to find a lawyer who believes that he's innocent.
Well, the evidence against him is very compelling. You're letting your feelings for him cloud your judgment.
100% Geschmack aus 100% reinem Hartweizen. Das sind 100%ig Zabler Hochzeitnudeln. Diesen Hochzeitnudeln.
Wonderful, isn't it? So the peak level is much lower on the commercial, but it's much louder. And the same is happening in music, to your right.
I've got a girl.
Yeah, wonderful again. So we want actually to end up in a situation like this, where we can have different degrees of peak level used from the different tracks, but everything is normalized to a predictable level here. And allow me to take a slight detour here, because it's something we have discussed recently, also in some of the groups Florian mentioned earlier, that we have a tendency of looking more to the engineering side than to the perceptual and neuroscientist side. And my background is actually over here, so let me just give you just a brief introduction to this. Normally, we would our senses, we would regard them or differentiate between reception and perception. So this is the outside world, and this is our inner life here, so to speak. So we have our senses here constantly giving us a lot of neurological inputs to the brain. So we have millions of neurons actually, but the brain of course is just locked away in its little room and only knows a little bit of what's happening. In fact, if you ask psychologists, we're only consciously aware of around 40 bits per second. So it depends on where we turn our attention at any given point in time. So this is very important to keep in mind when we're talking about any of our senses, for instance, hearing. So it's, of course, it's a protection from the tyranny of direct sensing. If we're aware of everything that happened around us, we would probably get completely neurological about things happening all the time that we couldn't influence anyway. So we are focusing on just a small fraction of all that. But that's only part of the story, because we also have latency built into our perception. So if something happened, that's the S here in time, any stimulus, any of your senses, and it only happens for a very short period of time, you won't notice it. For instance, if a fly lands on your chin and it sits there for 200 milliseconds and flies off again, you won't notice it. But if it sits there for more than 400 or 500 milliseconds, you will. And moreover, you will actually backwards refer it to when it arrived in the first place. So we have sort of like a reference system that brings things we should be aware of back in time. Of course, that doesn't work if you have to switch your attention from one sense to another one. It's one of the reasons why we react slowly, for instance, in traffic. If we are talking in mobile phones, then we actually take a long, long time before we even realize that something is wrong and we have to react to that. So unfortunately, it brings us in trouble in our daily lives also. This has further implications, of course. For instance, what is really the driving force in our inner life? Is it the mind or is it the body? And I won't get into those philosophical discussions, but it's very interesting, of course, what our conscious life really is. If it's just looking at what the body is doing and then making sense of that, or if we're actually in charge of what we're doing, but that's a different story. Anyway, we also have startle reflexes. That's in most of our senses, so we can react to sound much quicker, of course, than 400 or 500 milliseconds. If something loud happens, or if you're going to start a 100-meter race, you start based on startle and not on conscious perception. So anyway, just a bit more from the physiological side here. This is the brain from seen from below. This is the spinal cord here. And this is where all our senses arrive. They all arrive in the same area of the brain, namely the brainstem. So if we take a look through the brain here, this is a coronal section of the brain. It's the front here and the rear here. And this is the brainstem here, this area, 5, 3, 4, and 3. So that's called the brainstem. That's where all our senses arrive. So the acoustic nerve, for instance, arrives here, and it goes all the way up to the thalamus up here, and finally to the auditory cortex. So why am I even bothering you with this? It's because it actually has a very big influence on how we perceive things around us. This is the cochlea, and we have a synapse in the cochlear ganglion, and then at the brainstem. So this is the acoustic nerve here. So the important thing here is that we actually have two signal paths in the brain. We have a primary one where, for instance, we perform localization. This is the fastest processing in the human brain. That's where we are doing the delta processing between left and right ear, for instance. That's at the bottom of the brainstem. Then we move up the brainstem here, and this is where the startle reflexes happen, also way before our conscious mind, which is out here. Then through the thalamus, sort of the relay station of the brain, and finally to the auditory cortex. But we still have no conscious recognition of what's happening, because we need to involve the secondary, the reticular path here as well, where all the other senses are brought into play. And we have a lot of synapses here, and again, the thalamus is the final relay station, depending on a lot of priorities and external reasoning. It will maybe eventually allow the auditory cortex to be the one that is allowed to contribute to our conscious perception. So all of this is immensely important on how we're hearing things, because, for instance, short transients and peaks, they're not really part of this system. You have to hear things for a little while before you actually can, before you open for this connection here. So that makes a big difference also between an experienced listener and a non-experienced listener, or a trained listener or a non-trained listener, because this is also the area of the brain where speech recognition takes place and language recognition. So if you cannot decode short transients that are, we have phonemes in the words we are using, so you know the phonemes and you know localization, we use that in our daily lives, but if you're not an experienced engineer or an experienced listener, you haven't trained in transients and know how they should sound. So this is quite important. So with that in mind, have a listen to these two music examples here, and let me know if you can guess what is the difference between them. Anybody want to take a guess? No? It's also a little bit difficult, I must say, in a condition like this, because we have a reverberant hall. But actually, the peak level is very different. So they are normalized using R128, but the peak level was very different. Now, have a look at a peak meter while you're listening to them again. Okay, I hope you get my point. This is, if you're on a good speaker system and if you're a trained engineer, there's no doubt whatsoever which is which. But for an untrained listener or under relatively bad conditions like this, you probably cannot tell, unfortunately. So my main point is that loudness, the reason why we have loudness defined as it is in the standards, is very reasonable. There's no reason to go lower than 400 milliseconds, because you need to, if you have your attention somewhere else, then you won't direct your mind to any auditory event unless it lasts for a while. And only, as I said, only an experienced listener can pick up the transients, and he needs to have a good, or she needs to have a good speaker system also. So these are the three momentary short-term and programmed loudness of R128. And we know already that, for instance, if we have a program measured at minus 28, and our target is supposed to be minus 23, 5 dB gain change will put it on target. So I'm from the land of H.C. Andersen, so let me briefly tell you about three fairy tales about audio. They're here. It's that hyperlevel doesn't matter, that lossy data reduction is as good as CD, and that speech normalization is a universal measure across all broadcast programs. So here's an example, for instance, of what will happen if we are using a speech-based measure, or can happen if we're doing a speech-based measure across some programs. Notice where the different loudness, short-term momentary and the program loudness appears on this meter, so you can decode it. It's not to promote our meter. This can be any R128 meter, because they're supposed to show these things, just if you haven't seen it before.
Stop the car. Listen to me, Coppertop. We don't have time for 20 questions. Right now, there's only one rule. Our way or the highway?
Good evening. I wish to report a burglary. Speak up, Peter.
I wish to report a burglary.
I can't hear you, sir.
I wish to report a burglary!
That's a little bit too loud, sir. Could you say it just a little less loud than that?
I wish to report a burglary.
No, I'm still not getting anything. Could you try it in a higher register?
What do you mean, a higher register?
What?
I wish to report a burglary!
Oh, that's it. Hang on a moment. Now, a little bit louder.
I wish to report a burglary!
Report a what?
Burglary!
That's it. That's the exact frequency. Now, keep it there.
But I feel that if they really want to sell the product in... in this secular age, what they ought to do is to redo some of the liturgical music in popular song forms. I have a modest example here. It's called The Vatican Rag. First you get down on your knees, fiddle with your rosaries, bow your head with great respect and genuflect, genuflect, genuflect.
What you doing?
Oh, deciding what to wear. My first day back to work. Do I look fat in this?
I think you look good in everything.
Wow, your father has taught you well.
Dad, this is the best part! No! Dad, this is the best part, come on!
No,
this is the, I want to listen to it, okay?
Okay, so it really doesn't work very well across genres. But actually, we also know that the best method of normalizing, regardless if we're using tracks with mostly speech or with mostly music and effects, is the new R128 or PS1770-3 normalization method. Just to give you an indication of how much tolerance we have between programs, then you can expect around half of your listeners will adjust the remote if there's a systematic loudness increase of around 3 LU or a systematic decrease of 6, and that nearly all will do this if the loudness increases by 5 or decreases by 8. And it's important to note that any type of sound could trigger that desire to adjust the level. So for instance, also referring to what Simon was saying earlier this morning, this is important to keep in mind. A bit of terminology, because this is these issues should not be confused, or these three different terms should be kept separate. So we have peak to loudness ratio, loudness range, and headroom. So if we consider a full track, then this is the peak to peak relative to normalization level. You could call it true peak over loudness, while this one over here is loudness variation inside a track or a program. So the headroom is for a signal path instead. So you can consider this for the track, but this is how much headroom is needed to convey a particular track. So if you have a track with a peak to loudness ratio of 18 dB, then you need to have a signal path with a headroom of at least the same, so you don't run into any distortion. So let's have a further look at headroom and the signal path, because this is relevant for mobile and pod platforms as well. How much can we actually expect? If we're using the old measurement, the BS1770 measurement, without the gating, then we would think we would have headroom between target level and the maximum true peak level we allow. But that's not actually true, because a lot of the program will actually be using up some of the headroom for loudness variation. So a big part of the program will have a headroom only like this. And it's actually worse if we're using speech gating, because then we will have big parts of the program with a very small, if any, headroom at all. while the type of normalization that also not only provides the best balancing between programs, but also provides the most headroom for most parts of the program is the gated measurement, like so. So it makes a big difference which type of measurement you're using for your programs. Peak to loudness ratio, some examples of music in the green zone here, music in the yellow zone here, and music in the red zone down here. And interestingly, you can see that beat it appears, unfortunately, three times on this chart. This is the good mastering. You want to get the one from 82. These ones are just getting worse and worse as we go along. So if poor Michael Jackson would still have been alive, he would just have noticed that he was now in the red zone when he died. Poor guy. And poor us, if that had been all we had. Fortunately, we have this one still. So that's not the same. Peak to loudness ratio is not the same as loudness range. As you can see here, for instance, a very nice Donald Fagen track here sounds exquisite on good speakers, has a very small loudness range. So please don't get the two confused. This is sort of squashing ratio here. And this one over here is sort of how much loudness variation do you have inside a track. And this is sort of the storytelling tracks in this end and the ones that are more or less the same from start to end down here. An interesting new graph from Rudy Ortner, who recently did a thesis on loudness in music. These are the 10,000 most popular music tracks from US, UK and Germany since 1951. And you'll notice that the peak performance of our industry was in the mid 80s. Since then, it's just gone downhill. Regardless that we've got better and better converters, better consoles, better everything, we're still producing worse and worse sound, unfortunately. This is another example of the Michael Jackson track from 82 here, the original, where we have the three transients up here, as you can see. But down here in 2009, this is the 0 dB line. We are more or less sitting above zero most of the time, so we'll be in red light district of the CD players and of the codecs most of the time also. Tragic. But as you can see again, this peak level limiting doesn't really affect loudness range, but it certainly affects the peak to loudness ratio. Let's turn our attention to Apple platforms, because these devices, this is from an AES paper in 2009, they are revolving around minus 16, as Florian also mentioned before. And that means, for instance, that we can use a certain way of translating a wide loudness range program to for instance, a podcast on the Apple platform in a relatively audio-friendly way. The important thing is to remember to do all processing around your target level. So if we limit the peaks and we bring up the low-level stuff, we can end up shifting even a cinema production in an audio-friendly way to podcast, where you still will be able to enjoy it when you're on a plane, for instance. The problem here, without getting into too many technical details, is that if you sit at minus 23 in your podcast, then chances are that if you're on a plane or a train, you won't be able to turn up the volume enough. Unfortunately, this is another example of unnecessary rules being enforced for the wrong reasons, because the European iPods have a playback gain limitation. So it's the same as Florian said before, that some countries were doing this now, the playback gain trick in cinema, reducing the playback gain, but it's the last thing you want to do. You want to have enough playback gain, and you want to have enough playback gain in your iPods as well, because trying to reduce the playback gain to reduce hearing loss is the wrong way to go. That only makes you more likely to squash your stuff, because otherwise you cannot play them loudly enough on your iPod. So for instance, the Apple system, if the peak level is too high on a track, it won't be able to renormalize it. So that's why if you're doing podcasts, as we discussed at the P-Loud meeting recently, you should make sure that your peak to loudness ratio isn't so high that you cannot have the normalization system in the Apple devices bring it on target. This, for instance, I heard at the recent IBC, I heard a wonderful recording from the proms. It was actually from Royal Albert Hall, of course, and it's from this year. So I went back to SIS Live and asked them for a non-data reduced version of that. So I'll just want to play very briefly for you from here to here. So that's the second verse and the second chorus. And you can see this is the loudness range it's produced at. This is a plot of the full program. But it's a wonderful way, actually, of using loudness range, even in television. And you could convert this to iPods without anything getting lost, actually, by using the method I described before. But now first just have a listen to this. The picture side is data reduced, but we don't care about the picture. It's the audio side, so that's not data reduced.
Majestic shall thou rise, more dreadful from its torrent's throat, more dreadful, dreadful from its torrent's throat. As bellow blast, the blast that bears the skies, serves not to root thy native old.
Couple of very engaged singers in the chorus. But this is quite interesting that, and it's quite daring to do this on television, of course, but it sounds wonderful. Unfortunately, the reproduction, the speakers in this hall aren't that great, but the better speakers you use, the better this sounds. It's absolutely an amazing TV production. So that's actually done on just within the limitations we're using today, as you could see on the numbers also. So I think we should actually discriminate between target and distribution level. The important thing is to normalize to one target level. So then we get the distinction between foreground sound and background sound defined across all platforms. So for podcasts, some advice here. You don't have enough playback gain if you seat them at minus 23, at least not if you're using Apple devices. Soundcheck can boost the program if the peak to loudness ratio is less than 16. So the distribution level should be between minus 16 and minus 23, but as long as you keep the peak to loudness ratio below 16. Mobile, it's actually worse because now we have both, I did a recent investigation on Samsung devices as well. They're actually worse than Apple devices. So in this case, we actually, because it's live streaming, you shouldn't go lower than minus 16 because then there's a risk that you won't be able to turn it up loudly enough. So this is the best way of getting a full circle from production over ingest to transmission and logging without getting more processing than necessary. We should only process when it's absolutely necessary. So this is a self-improving, hopefully, circle where if we're using the same measures, we can get back from logging to production and say, hey guys, this program is systematically too loud or too soft. A few guidelines for loudness range as I see it. For instance, that if you're outputting for podcast, then don't go much below 8 LU on loudness range, but you can be much higher, of course, on the HD platform. A few dilemmas here on the use of Dolby E and AC3. The floating metadata thing, more things to go wrong. And it's also worse for logging, actually. It complicates logging. It doesn't work across platforms, and it's sort of it's proprietary data anyway. Audio quality, I think we should rather keep it linear until transmission instead of building up latency in the chain. AC3 DRC is not BS1770 compliant, and I think it's very important to turn it off to avoid sausage processing at the consumer. 95% of the consumers will be listening to DRC with RF mode, So that's actually quite a bottleneck, a sausage bottleneck right there. And the German broadcasters were depressed last week that they got now the very good things happening in production, but they could hear that they still had processing going on, and that was actually in the consumer device itself. Downmix is another issue. AC3 may distort. There's a lack of headroom for downmixing, and there's a downmix dilemma I hope you'll tackle later today, maybe Florian, I don't know, maybe not. Getting the best out of AC3, normalized programs at the station protect AC3 from peak overload. The RF mode system only has a headroom of 20 dB, so you need at least to go down to -3 in stereo and -6 in 5.1. Change metadata only when switching between stereo and 5.1. And remember that the decoder is not speech-based. It's just at average level of the program, like Simon also said before. So, a few words at the end. For music and broadcast production, avoid the lossy data reduction. No LRA, try to settle expectations early so you don't need processing later on. Don't go above -15 in music. Broadcast, hit your target. Use program loudness to normalize the one with the gating, because then you're maximizing headroom also. The free transients are important. It's the you can't sound good on good speakers if you don't have a certain degree of free transients. It's also important for speech intelligibility and for clarity, and you should train your ears because otherwise you can't hear it. Use true peak limiting. If you only have a sample peak meter, stay lower. Calibrated speakers, MS check for data reduced delivery. Speech level, that's an important one, should sit between -4 and 8 and 0. Don't go to -10 or something. That will only give you problems downstream. Expect normalization based on the gated measure, or better if a new one comes along. Then a few tracks here to hopefully discourage you a little bit from the Stone Age of music, where I had to set the meter at target -6. So have a listen to this. The radar will not reset, but this one over here will reset between the tracks. So we have first the Danish pop song, Kelly Clarkson, Metallica, and Full Scale Pink Noise. Men alone, sidder jeg her helt alene. For du er i Marienlyst, mamma Lena. Din lejlighed er lidt brændt ned. Din flæt er solgt til skrot. Og dit tøj er spredt ud over Vesterbro. Men din kat, den har det godt. So when is the last time you found full-scale Pink Noise soft? But it actually, on a good speaker system, it actually sounds better than all these three. So that's interesting as well. So our enemies are actually sausage processing, lossy data reduction, and hyperlevel. And the one we've taken care of so far is hyperlevel. So make sure that we go all the way, because this is really the only way of getting audio back into this equation, because it's a well-known fact that the only way of extending this bandwidth a little bit is through art, and you can read a lot of that from different psychologists. This is basically the only way of getting a higher bandwidth into our mind. So that's regardless if we're considering paintings, if we're considering written or book, or if we're considering music. And it's really a pain or a pity if this point in time where we have all the conditions for doing everything right on the audio side, that we are wasting it by just squashing everything completely. So that's what I have to say. Thanks for listening.